Well, hello, everybody. I'm Greg Schimese.
And I'm Zoe Breen.
And Zoe, this is the 20th, believe it or not, the 20th film festival here in East Hampton.
You know, that I just can't believe that, Greg. Is that really true, the 20th?
I know, but you could tell because 20 years ago I had the same jacket on, so. And I was swimming in it because I was a lot thinner. But Zoe, it's...
Here we are again.
It's amazing.
It's like, it's great to see you on the other side of the camera, Greg. We never get to see those beautiful cheeks.
I know. It's horrible,
but
it's a lot of fun. And today is the kickoff day, and basically it's going to be unbelievable. There's a lot of, we start with Marilyn Monroe, and it...
Oh, that's going to be great. Oh,
terrific opening day film.
What's your favorite part of the film festival each year?
I like the young filmmakers, actually.
Me too.
And over the years, believe it or not, the young filmmakers, who are now old filmmakers, because 20 years later, you look at them, and they started out with a five-minute film, and we interviewed them for 15 minutes, because I felt sorry for them being a father of filmmakers. I always say, well, the parents at home are still paying off the tuition and notes, so I want to give them a chance to at least have a little bit of pride. And over the years, we've noticed that quite a few of them, too numerous to mention, have gone on to work in front of, behind the camera, and do legal work, and do TV work, and all sorts of things.
And they're all grown up.
They're all grown up.
Wow.
And here in East Hampton, as in Suffolk County, we're trying to promote the film industry as a business, as a growth business. You know, now with this economic crisis that we're in, and East Hampton and the whole Suffolk County and the whole New York State, in fact, is having problems. We feel that the film industry is a great industry for everyone to get involved with. And I'm a carpenter, I'm a hairdresser, I'm a tailor. Well, those people are impacted. If there's a movie being shot in your town, the film crews eat at the restaurants, and they frequent the barber shops, and they get their clothes mended in the tailor shops and things like
that. And they might even need extras.
And they might need extras.
I mean, you never know.
Because of, for instance, Royal Pains and Revenge, that are two TV projects we're proud of. But
here we are, we have beautiful weather. You almost wish for rain, though, right? So you go hide in those theaters.
Actually, we're filming this in a sound studio. It's raining outside, but
The beautiful Maidstone Arms in East Hampton, and where they have the living room, the fabulous restaurant.
Fabulous restaurant. Yep. It's all refurbished at the Maidstone, so come on down. If you can't watch us, on TV, watch us on the on your iPod and iPad appliance.
It's so nice because even if you're in the village, you can walk down. It's a beautiful walk here. I just love that sidewalk with the trees, and it's just such a nice
perfect time to be in the Hamptons. Perfect
sure
time.
Is.
So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
So I'm here with Doron Weber from the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. Hi, Doron.
Hi, good to see you again.
Now, for some of our viewers, can you tell us a little bit about the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation and what your role is here at the film festival?
Well, we're founded in 1934. We make grants in science, technology, and economics. And about over a decade ago, we started a program to encourage leading artists in film, television, and theater to create more realistic and compelling stories about science and technology, and to depict scientists, engineers, and mathematicians in a fresh light. So we have Hamptons is one of our partner for about 12 years now, and we have a big prize, feature film prize here, and we develop screenplays. We're having screenplay readings, all for films that deal with science and technology in some way or another.
So how do you find these films, or do people find you?
Both. We fund six film schools, and we have three other partners besides Hamptons, Sundance, Tribeca, and Film Independent, and we get our own. We have over probably 300 projects over the years, and we nurture them in what I call a farm system, so we give them multiple grants. So this year we've had four feature films come out, of which one is Future Weather. Mm-hmm. People do come to us, but we also find them through these institutional partners of ours.
Well, I think the last time I saw you, I think it was like 7 years ago at the Sundance Film Festival. But so is that your role? Do you go to these film festivals, and what do you do?
Well, I started this program when I came to Sloan. It said we don't do the arts, and I've basically any script that has ever gotten Sloan Award, I read everything myself. So I'm the kind of, it's pretty much of a one-man band in terms of, I mean, we have committees and all of that, but, and so in terms of quality control over the years, you know, my job is to really read everything and make sure that it fits the, you know, the mission of the foundation, and also that it's, in the end, it's a film program, so it's really, we're really just looking for the best scripts that, you know, we want to develop. And we also have a theater program, so it's grown. It's a very big
program. Here you are. You're still very hands-on. Is that important to you?
Well, it is. It's important to me, and it's important to the foundation because they were going into territory that they didn't know and they weren't comfortable with. And so, I'm there to make sure that, you know, it's adhering to the, you know, to the mission of the foundation. But also, we by now we have our partners like Hamptons, like Sundance, like Tribeca, have become much more adept at finding these projects themselves. So they really scour. They go internationally and looking for them. And I think the word has gotten out, so we get a lot more submissions now. The program really has matured, and we're working. We have other independent projects that we're working on with fairly well-known directors and producers who have, you know, have come to us. So I think it's since you and I spoke, things have really developed in a very positive direction for us.
Wow, that's amazing! Congratulations. I mean, that's a
Thank
huge
you.
Job that you've done, but amazingly. So what brings you to the Hamptons International Film Festival? Which films?
Well, the film, actually, at 3:45 today, okay. I don't know how live you go, but Future Weather, which is a beautiful film that we gave multiple grants to by Jenny Deller, first-time director. And one of the things I like about this film, the central character is a young woman, a teenager, whose mother abandons her, and she finds in science a kind of way to deal with her own problems. She wants to save the universe from climate change. But what's really remarkable about the film is it's really three generations of women, and it's and all of them are presented in a really interesting light. And Amy Madigan, who plays the grandmother, gives an incredible, I think, performance. Shows one of the things is that a woman who's no longer, let's say middle age, no longer, you know, she's a grandmother, but who's still sexual on camera. And as you know, those kind of roles for women are very rare because we have a fairly just like we stereotype scientists and engineers, we tend to stereotype women. So I think it's a kind of, for me, it's a kind of breakthrough performance. She's an amazing actress. And there's the young woman, the lead, also is remarkable. So it's really a I don't want to say it's a women's film, but the women really shine in this. It's just beautifully acted, directed by, as I said, a woman, Jenny Deller, who's very gifted. So we're really excited about helping it see the light of day, and hopefully it'll get distributed. That's the, you know, that's the big, that's the goal, right? Get into theaters.
Yeah. Is that the only film that you guys are working with here?
We have two screenplays. We're having, on Sunday, we have screenplay readings. Melissa Leo is going to be reading for one of our scripts. The Buck Decision, which is based on a true story that well into the 50s, America, we were sterilizing women who were perceived to be not intelligent or working class, or, you know, an incredible, like the kind of thing you think happened, you know, 100 years ago, but was still, so it's about a scandal where someone discovered that this had been going on. And then the other script is called Magnetic, and it's a period thing about Elizabeth I in a relationship with a scientist, doctor, who did pioneering research in magnetism, but frankly, it's really about their personal relationship and how they develop a kind of late life romance.
Wow.
So it's kind of, so, and two very different takes on science and technology, which, as you know, is, you know, full of infinite, it's not white lab coats. I mean, there are a lot of ways to, you know, to find creative work, you know, that fits that mandate. So we're, you know, again, we're very pleased with the range of material that's coming out.
Oh, sounds fantastic. I want to see every, I want to hear the screenplays read, and I want to see that film. And you said you're going to be on a panel as well?
Yeah, we have a panel afterwards. We traditionally bring scientists and filmmakers together to talk about, so I think we have a climate scientist who's going to come and talk about some of the, I guess, truth versus what's in the film, what's real, what's happening today, how accurate is it, and then we're going to have some of the actors from the film there. And those panels tend to draw a lot. I think it's this idea of bringing the two cultures together, of science and the arts, and people are interested in that because we tend to stay within our own culture as a rule, and so bringing them together, it yields interesting, I don't want to say fireworks, but the results are interesting.
Absolutely,
yeah.
It makes for a fantastic film, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I know you're busy, so thank you so much for sitting down and joining us, and I'll see you around the festival, definitely.
Okay, great to see you, thanks
you,
very
Doron.
Much.
Nice to see you.
Well, I'm here with Jenny Deller, I got the name right.
That's right.
And the name I don't want to get wrong is Future Weather, an exciting movie, the Sloan Foundation winner,
And we're very proud to have you. The Sloan Foundation means a lot to the festival and to us. And so welcome to the festival.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm excited to be here.
And tell us a little bit about Future Weather.
Future Weather is a coming-of-age drama starring a sensational new actress named Perla Haney Jardine. She gives a fantastic performance as a 13-year-old girl who is abandoned by her mother and decides to take survival into her own hands.
Incredible. And it was shot on the West Coast?
It was actually shot outside of Philadelphia.
Really?
Yeah, the story is set in the Midwest, rural kind of countryside, but we found a lot of great locations outside of Philadelphia where I was based at the time.
And what brought you to the project?
I wanted to tell a mother-daughter story that we hadn't seen before, you know, about a mother and daughter who were polar opposites, and the mother is sort of the irresponsible kid and the daughter is more like the mother. Mm-hmm. And as I started to develop a character who's really interested in the environment and science, I became interested in global warming and saw this really fantastic connection and thought, if I'm concerned about it, I think a 13-year-old kid would be as well.
And let's speak about the Sloan Foundation Award. And over the years, they've imparted on filmmakers, young and old, an incredible opportunity. And no one goes out to build a movie to be sort of in that catchment of the Sloan catchment for to qualify. But your movie certainly did, and it's a beautiful movie. But basically, what does it mean to be a Sloan Award winner?
It kind of puts this stamp of approval from the scientific community onto the project, I think. They set a standard that a film, if it's going to contain science, it should be accurate and it should be socially relevant as well. So I'm just thrilled. It kind of proved that all of the work that I did really paid off.
It is. It's a very prestigious honor, and I'm so happy that your movie was selected. Basically, your background, how did you get in the business? What brought you to it?
I've always been interested in storytelling. Mm-hmm. Since I was little, I was writing, then I got into acting and theater, and mm-hmm. just couldn't get it out of my system, so.
And what media was it shot on?
We shot on the red.
And what did you think of that?
Beautiful. Looks like film. Our cinematographer did a fantastic job. Lighting really looks like, you know, beautiful cinema.
It's a very lush look. And
yeah.
And the idea of having the red camera is so flexible, and it sure beats carrying around those big Panavision things with that old technology of film. Right?
I read the red's still pretty bulky, but it means that, you know, post production is a lot less of a hassle and a lot cheaper.
And in post, what did you use to cut it up?
My own Apple computer on Final Cut Pro.
All right. Final Cut without the revisions, right?
Exactly.
Let that be a lesson to you youngsters out there. Don't get all the revisions. But I'm so excited about the movie. Again, it's Future Weather, and I see that even in the Sundance, you were... the Tribeca Film Festival you were honored.
Yeah, we premiered at the Tribeca Film Festival in April. It's fantastic.
So now, is there a website or a point that people could, a Twitter or a Facebook? Well, let the viewers at home have it.
We have all of it. Come to our Facebook page. It's, you know, just type in Future Weather. We're also on Twitter. It's just @FutureWeather. And we have a website that keeps you posted on all of our screening dates. And we're basically screening for the next 6 weekends all across the country at different festivals.
Well, it's worth seeing. And any distributors pick it up?
Putting the final touches on that deal.
Good.
Can't talk about it yet. Yeah.
No, that's a very, very wise thing to say. And your next project, what are you working on next?
It's a script based on the life story of Jane Elliott, who is a really atypical civil rights crusader.
Excellent.
So.
Well, I hope you film it out here on Long Island, because we're trying to encourage filming here in Suffolk County.
Cool.
So take advantage of that 30% tax.
That's a good one.
You know, to here in New York State. Thanks again, and the movie again is Future Weather, and this is Jenny Deller, the power behind Future Weather. Thanks, Jenny.
Thank you.
So pretty much anywhere in any store and restaurant, they sell these guides to the 2012 film guide for the Hamptons International Film Festival. But I just want to share with the viewers that if you want more information, specific information, you can go to HamptonsFilmFest.org. So that's HamptonsFilmFest.org, and you might want to check it out, because there's a lot going on, and you'll probably want to schedule and organize your weekend. So HamptonsFilmFest.org.
Dan, tell me about this wonderful movie. I've been hearing it's a North American premiere here, a 90-minute in English, and it's going to be here at the festival, and it's going to be at the Sag Harbor Theater in UA3. But give me an idea of the viewers at home, what to expect.
Sure. It's an adaptation of a hit off-Broadway play that was at Manhattan Theater Club a few years ago, and I got together with the playwright, Joe Hortua, and we wrote the adaptation, and I directed it, and we have a terrific cast with Julia Stiles and Taye Diggs and Melissa George and David Harbour, who's about to go on Broadway in Glengarry Glen Ross. It's basically two couples yelling and throwing things at each other. It's sort of in the vein of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. So
you could have filmed that in my apartment building. It's terrific. That's amazing.
Exactly.
And it's so topical because of, you know, with the economic crunch, people yelling and screaming all the time. And what motivated you to do it? First of all, you have an exquisite cast, and your producers are unbelievable. I met them. And I just want to know what provoked you to do it.
I was just looking for material. This is my third or fourth film, and I had done, the last film I did was a real estate musical, because no one else had done that, and there was talk of turning that into a Broadway or off-Broadway show, and while I went in to have those meetings, I said, well, look, do you guys have any plays that would make good film adaptations? And they said, yeah, here's stacks of them. And I read some really great material. I actually passed on the play that turned out to be Ides of March, that Clooney fella. Took my sloppy seconds and got a good happy ending off of that. And he did fine, you know.
Yeah.
That he's going places,
I've
that kid.
Him, yeah.
And but I thought this Between Us actually sort of spoke more to me, sort of where I am in my life, you know, married with kids and dealing with financial problems and artistic integrity. And it's because it's really very much the story of two photographers, and one who sells out and one who doesn't. And you know, what is the price of that?
What is the price of art? Any distributors?
Not yet, but this is our big North American premiere. I just came from Germany and Greece, where we had our European premieres, and really distributors aren't seeing it until today, I hope. So.
Well, that's always a thing, and we've been doing this event for 20 years, and I always throw that in. And I think that along the way, we've people sitting at home, they get up and they, you know, run to the phone and grab their checkbook or whatever they do, and they say, that's a good deal. I want to get on the ground floor of something good. And your next project, what are you working on now?
I'm looking at some other adaptations of either novels or plays, so a little too early to talk about them publicly yet, but... But that's what's going to be next. And then I'm one of the co-founders of the Slam Dance Film Festival.
Oh, wow, my God, that's terrific.
So that keeps me a little bit
busy.
That's
an exciting thing. I mean, and then you still have your hair and teeth. That's terrific.
Well, that's why I wear a hat, so you can't really tell.
Yeah. Unbelievable. Now, I know the film, again, is Between Us. And the website or Facebook?
BetweenUsMovie.com, but also we have a Facebook page. And... and people can follow me on the Twitter at Dan Marvish, and or some of our actors, you know, Taye Diggs and some of the other ones. So, just follow along, and we hope to have a trailer up online sometime within the next week. And then if you miss it here at the Hamptons, we're screening at the Woodstock Film Festival next weekend. So.
Oh, have Woodstock back again.
Yeah.
Thanks again, Dan. It's a pleasure,
and
welcome to the Hamptons, and good luck. And
thanks,
I hope that the viewers out there get up off their couches and come out to the theaters and follow this movie. It's terrific. Between Us, North American premiere here in the Hamptons.
I'm here with Julia Garner from Electrick Children. Hi,
hi.
Welcome.
Hi, nice to see you.
Nice to have you here on this beautiful day.
Thank you. It is very beautiful.
Gosh. So tell me about Electrick Children. Tell me about the film.
It's about a Mormon girl who gets an immaculate conception by listening to rock and roll music, and she's trying to find the Joseph to her Jesus baby. So Yeah.
Tell me about immersing yourself in this world, especially in the Mormon world. You had to probably learn about that.
I mean, I knew a little bit about it before. I didn't have much time to prepare because I auditioned. I did a self-taping on Monday, got it the job by Wednesday, and was shooting by Tuesday.
Wow.
And
is that a good thing, though, or do you want?
I think so. I mean, that doesn't really happen. Rarely happens. So, but yeah. So I did know a little bit about it, but the film isn't about Mormonism. It just has that part of it in the film, just a tiny part. So, yeah.
Wow. So, what was the most surprising turn of events that you came away like realizing maybe about yourself or? Through this character, through finding this character.
What did I learn?
Yeah, what did you find, like, what did you find out about yourself through playing this character? Do you find things?
It's weird. It's like almost like I know that I grew as a person, I guess, mm-hmm. but I don't know how, kind of. It's just, it's kind of there, just, it's indescribable.
So now that you've developed this character and you put a lot into developing mm-hmm. and making it real, how do you let go of that character?
How do I let go of the character? Well, I actually had, of Electrick Children, you mean?
Yes, yes.
Well, I actually, right after the film, I had another film.
Oh, wow.
So I just had to, it wasn't a choice. I had to do it.
Do you store pieces of these characters in somewhere that you can, like, you know, take parts of that and use it for
What do you mean by that?
Like do you keep, like, things that you've kind of discovered in this film? Do you store, like, ideas and then use them again in another film? Like, parts of this character,
I mean,
do you think you'll ever use her again in another film?
Maybe. You never know. For now, no. I don't know where I can put a Mormon girl in any of the films that I've played. But, I guess there's different characteristics that you can add, so.
Okay, so when does this film air?
What?
When does this film air?
I think in January.
When is it playing here at the film festival?
It's playing actually today, and it played yesterday.
Great.
So 5:30, I believe.
So are you nervous when you go?
A little bit, but I didn't, so I get a little nervous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's all good. Yeah. And was there a lot of support during the filming for
you?
Yeah,
a lot. I mean, I was 17 at the time when I was filming it, so I had my mother there, and it was good. It was good, for my first leading film, so.
This is your first.
Yes.
Oh, my God, I'm asking all these questions. No wonder. You're like, I don't know, maybe.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Wow. So now you're really busy, though, promoting it.
Yeah.
And doing other films.
Yes. I have, like, 7 films that are being edited right now. So it's just been crazy. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Well, good luck with this film.
Thank you.
Congratulations on your first film.
What's your name again?
Zoe.
Nice to meet you, Zoe.
Yeah, so nice to meet you, Julia. And enjoy the beautiful weather.
Thank you
very much. And good luck with the film today.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So I'm here with Alan Sali Hofmanis. Hofmanis or Hofmanis?
Hofmanis, yes.
Hofmanis. Almost. I almost got it. And you're here with the film Wakliwood.
Wakliwood, the documentary, yes.
The documentary.
Yes.
So tell me about it.
I don't know anything
about it.
I don't know where to begin.
I know. Tell me at the beginning. How did you get involved?
It's very simple. It may sound a little crazy, but not to me. Back in December, so this isn't that long ago, I saw 90 seconds of footage on YouTube mm-hmm. of this movie trailer that was insane and brilliant and genius and crazy. Explosions, helicopters, cast of 100. Couldn't get it out of my head. So I did what anyone would do, I think, and I went to Uganda. And I tracked them down, which is the whole story. But it's essentially a community, about 100 people, that's what they do essentially for a living is produce Hollywood-inspired action films from the slums surrounding Kampala, Uganda, which means, say, their tripod is modified carjacked, the guns are carved out of blocks of wood or welded out of scrap metal, the computers are built out of spare parts when they can find them.
Was your jaw just on the ground in the first few days when you were experiencing this?
I was, from the moment I saw the footage, frankly, because I think he's the real deal.
Yeah.
But then when I got there, I thought I was going to meet someone like myself, meaning someone a little crazy but with some friends and a camera. I spoke with him for just the first few minutes. We talked for 5 hours the first night, and I realized that he's the real deal.
There's a couple things that I really like about this story. Yes. One is that you just got up and you went to Uganda. Okay, that's right? Like, that's amazing.
I did not even call first.
And then the other thing is that nothing stops him from doing this. He can do this no matter what. And I think that is such an amazing, empowering thought that, you know, you don't need tons of money. No. You can do it. Just get out there and do it. And you just got out there and you did it.
Yep. And to give you an idea, he's 39 now. Okay. He always wanted to make films, but he made the decision at the birth of his first child when he was 31. In those 8 years, he produced 32 feature films.
Wow.
Yep. And they're hugely popular, but in the slums around, not even in Kampala.
What do you mean when you say he's the real deal? Like, what is it about his style?
He has many talents that are completely separate from each other. The same person can build a computer out of spare parts and get it working, and then build a distribution model on how to make money selling DVDs, to put it in perspective, to people who don't even have electricity. They may have it, but they might not have a TV. Maybe they have a DVD player or someone else, but they're so wanted so much that they maybe get together as extended family and watch it once a month. But he sets that up. Plus, he can organize 100 different people in different crews, from kung fu actors to stunt people to actors to prop masters to technicians, and then write and direct. And plus, you see it in the film just how charming he is, but how he's able to, in a third language, because he speaks Luganda, then Swahili, but in English, he speaks English, able just to express his ideas and his visions so clearly. And I think we all know, like, really talented, like, I know a bunch of musicians who are insanely talented, they can't hold a conversation. Right. You know, they can't, just because he just blows me away. And so he has all these different talents and the things in the combination that I've seen very rarely.
How did making this documentary change you?
You know, it's funny. My life has always been film in different capacities, whether I work in production and then I became a curator. I was actually a volunteer here at the Hamptons.
Wait, is this your first documentary?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
And nice. Yeah. Congratulations.
But it's just, you just realize you can do anything.
You came out and you're still alive.
You did it.
Oh, I'm going back. You kidding me?
Right?
I'm in it. Yeah. In simple terms, I went there because I knew I wanted to work with him. And just after the first conversation, I want to work for him.
So, there's so much footage I'm sure you came back with. How did you pick and choose, and do you have somebody who helps you with the editing process? I mean, how hard is that for you?
Oh, no, we have two editors. It's of course, the choices and whatnot. But when I came back, I realized this is a project I think is much bigger than me. Mm-hmm. And the only person that kept coming back in my head was Ben Barinholtz, as a producer. He was the honoree, I think 2010, here at the Hamptons. But he was a good idea. He produced things like Raising Arizona, Barton Fink, and Miller's Crossing.
How did you get in touch with him?
Well, I've known him.
Took your call?
I've known him for about 10 years or so, but more socially, because I had a film festival of my own, because I'm always involved in this. And so he was a guest of mine.
Okay.
And so I heard him speak. I knew of him, and just his massive talents that he has in both distribution and production, exhibition, that he was the one. And so it was just the two of us.
What a journey.
Yeah. And then he was this first conversation. He looks at some of the footage. I think even barely. Just saw some, listened to me, and he's like, all right.
So Wakliwood, right?
Wakliwood.
And why is it called Wakliwood? Because this is where.
Great. This is the first night when we're sitting down, the children are playing, and wife's making me tea, and we're talking. And he's like, you know, I have a dream. Like that one American of yours, I too have a dream. Wakliwood. And what it comes from is that the slum that they live in is called Wakaliga. Mm-hmm. And Wakliwood.
Fantastic. Yeah. Now, when is your film documentary going to air?
The first screening is Friday, the 5th at 4:30, but it's also Sunday night at 8:45 at the Hamptons, the East Hamptons.
And you'll be there for both?
Are you kidding me?
How is that? How is that sitting in there and showing your film? Is that horrifying or no?
I honestly don't know yet. This is the world premiere. I do not know.
Okay,
all
so
I know
we'll
is
see.
I'm, you know, I love it. Whether it's on a monitor or on a phone.
Well, Alan, congratulations. Fantastic. You're here. And the journey sounds like an amazing journey that keeps going.
This is the end of the beginning.
Well, our viewers won't want to miss it. Wakliwood. Thanks, Alan. Have a great time at the festival.
Thank you.
I hope I can get in there and see it. Definitely.
Romeo, Romeo. Great movie world premiere here, and I'm with Lizzie Gottlieb, a fellow Brooklynite. Lizzie, welcome to the film festival.
Thank you so much.
I love the idea of the movie. It's a world premiere, 76 delightful, compelling minutes of this motion picture, and we're proud to have it. And I want you to, because if I tell the plot, I usually blow the whole thing, but I want you to do it. This way you have that artistic restraint that we need.
Sure. it's a documentary. I follow a young lesbian couple from their sort of big Italian-American lesbian wedding on their quest to have a child. They've always longed for a baby, and they decide to start their family together, and it turns out to be extremely complicated for them. And it turns into a story of infertility, which is a story that's really close to my heart that I'd actually originally wanted to make a film about. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of about the emotional, logistical, and financial struggles that couples, both gay and straight, go on when they cannot have the child that they've dreamed of. And it has a very surprising ending.
Well, that's amazing. It's a wonderful story, and on many levels, and, you know, touches the hearts of many that, you know, the idea of people think, oh, you're going to get married, you're going to have a child, and you live happily ever after, like, you know, every family that you see on TV and every family in the movies. But it's a struggle. And although the idea of having, you know, conception is automatic and biologically determined, there's a hardship involved and an incredible cost, emotional and financial. And I'm glad you did the movie, because there's an awful lot of people out there that silently suffer going through this. And what brought you to the project?
Well, as I said, I originally wanted to make a film on infertility. It was something I had gone through and felt very isolated and alone during that process. And I later met so many people who'd been through the same sort of struggles and felt that their experience had been so similar to mine. Mm-hmm. And I really wanted to tell that story. And then as I was trying to figure out how to make that documentary, my friends had just gotten married and we're starting the process of trying to have a baby as a gay couple. And I thought, you know, why don't I first make that film mm-hmm. about a gay family and what that's like for them and what the mm-hmm. process is like for them. Started filming, and it turned into, unfortunately for them, turned into the story I had originally intended to make. Mm-hmm. So I stayed with them for the next several years as they went through this process.
And first of all, a question about the equipment. What did you shoot on? To be that comfortable to shoot those many, many hours of intimate footage that you had to sort of process. What equipment did you use?
Well, I, as you said, it was a really intimate story, and so I shot it all myself, for better and for worse. I didn't feel like I could send a camera person into a room where Lexi was, you know, having her doctor's appointments and were there in their apartment sobbing. You know, it was all very, very personal and intimate. So I shot it on a relatively small, similar to that mm-hmm. camera, the HVX, mm-hmm. some of it on the
HVX. We're shooting on the Instamatic, which
oh, all right, well, and then some of it is shot on, I had a very small, lower resolution camera that I gave to the girls, the women, to shoot things themselves when things were going on when I wasn't there, you know, late at night. There are a few scenes that they shot.
Now, it's always intriguing to me, because I'm a big fan of documentaries, how the camera, at a certain point, the tipping point, where it's not even considered an observer in the room, that it becomes almost, it is, invisible. So did that happen, and how soon did it happen in the production?
I was really surprised. I felt that it happened very quickly. Lexi, one of the two women in the film, was, I have twin boys, and Lexi was their nanny when they were babies.
How cool is that?
And that's how I knew her. And we live in a house in Brooklyn, and Lexi and her wife, Jessica, moved into our basement apartment. We have an apartment there. And so we knew each other intimately already. Mm-hmm. And they knew that I had gone through a lot of the same sort of infertility treatments, obviously, before I knew them. Mm-hmm. So we're very comfortable with each other. And I felt that Lexi and Jessica very, very quickly didn't seem to notice that the camera was there. Mm-hmm. And that was really great. And I think I felt very comfortable being there with them because mm-hmm. I care about them so much. And, you know.
Lovely. How old are your twin boys?
They just turned 9.
Oh, that's a great age.
It
terrific.
Is.
That's great. You know, I have two sons too, and it's always an amazing thing to watch them grow and watch them sort of become individuals. And it's terrific, and the dynamic is important. And you know what comes across is how painful, both from the mom side and the potential dad side, or whatever the configuration the parents are to be a parent, that there's something inside of us that wants to be a parent. And it's something that I guess it promotes our, you know, as we diminish, they increase. So it's always good. But I'm very proud about the picture. I'm very proud about the world premiere here. And are you working on another project?
Just starting something, but not sure I can.
Brooklyn-based?
Unfortunately not.
Oh, okay.
I know.
Now, I want to say here, and I'll put a plug in for Suffolk County, that we're promoting in the county, because I'm one of the film commissioners as well, to film here on Suffolk County, because it's a great place. I mean, you got farms, you got everything. You got, yeah. You know, two handsome brothers that own a television set. But but you have a lot of stuff that you can mine, you know, and so keep that in mind for your next project. We have a big sound studio too, so right here in close proximity. But I'm looking forward to watching this beautiful movie. I encourage everybody to see it. Easy title, Romeo, Romeo. And website, email, Facebook?
RomeoRomeoTheMovie.com is our website, and okay. Also on Facebook.
So look at it, RomeoRomeoTheMovie.com. Look for it. Any distributors?
Not yet.
Okay. Now, my favorite thing is, for the people at home, all those boys and girls with their checkbooks here on the East End in particular, and if you're in Manhattan and in Brooklyn, you know, here's an opportunity to get at the bottom, at not you know, to take a creative piece like this and you know, invest in it. This is something that should be encouraged. Independent filmmaking should be encouraged, and certainly documentaries. So check it out from an investor's point of view. It's definitely worthwhile. Again, Romeo, Romeo, RomeoRomeoTheMovie.com. Thank you. And I'm here with Lizzie Gottlieb, a fellow Brooklynite. And there's nothing like Brooklyn. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Rising from the ashes, I'm here with the director, T.C. Johnson. Hello.
How are you?
Welcome to the Hamptons International Film Festival.
Thanks.
Congratulations.
Yeah, we're really glad to be here.
I haven't seen your film. Can you tell our viewers a little bit about it?
Yeah, this film's taken 7 years to make. We started in 2005, and it's the story of kind of two worlds colliding of a coach that kind of was coming out of his own redemption story, the first American to ride in the Tour de France, coming to Rwanda to basically build the first ever Rwandan cycling team. And their dream of one day going to the Olympics.
Wow, and then with you here is Obed.
Yes.
Hi. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you too.
Now, what part in the movie are you?
This movie is from Rwandan cycling team.
So are you a cycler in the
film? Yes, yes.
Wow.
You see many pictures for me to start to 2005 and this year.
Wow, so 7 years of your life. How hard is that to kind of finish and just, you know, to actually be like, I'm done?
Yeah, I mean,
exciting.
Yeah, it was kind of it was a super huge risk in the beginning. Just the idea of doing a film like this, of you just don't know kind of what you're getting into, and you just take it piece by piece. And the story really evolved from a small concept into a really big redemption story is what kind of happened, and the ending we would have never dreamed of.
So it's part of the conflict resolution series here at the Film Festival. And when does it air?
It airs this afternoon, I think at 5 o'clock. So it's, it's going to be a great show.
And you'll be there.
I will be there, yeah.
How is that, having people come and see your film and sitting in the theater? Is that horrifying, exciting?
You know, the process of making this film, we've gone through so much, you know, the process has been so hard. It's like, I just hope you guys enjoy it. I think the work's been done and the test screen has gone well. So we're excited about it. And it's, our goal with the film is that it wouldn't be just something that somebody would watch. We hope that they would see something that applies to their own life. And, you know, Obed and the rest of our kind of crew and people on the team, I mean, their story is just so big and inspiring.
What did you use to film this film?
Yeah, well, in 7 years, it's kind of crazy. We walked into this kind of technology. Yeah, so we started on tape and ended in digital, and we've shot every format you can imagine. And, yeah, it's been crazy. But one of the things that we've really been excited about is that we tried to really push the cinematic look of the film. So it's not your traditional kind of cycling film. It's really the bike became a vehicle for a bigger story.
Wow. So was it difficult actually filming these bikers? I mean, did you have to follow behind? Did you have a car?
Yeah.
Did you bike a lot?
No, yeah, I always say these guys are, Obed's a cyclist and these guys, and I spent more time on a motorcycle than I did. But yeah, we really tried to push it. I mean, everything from helicopters to, I mean, you name it. So chase cars. But I'm just glad I'm alive after this deal. I mean, this
yes,
one, Rwanda is a really interesting place, is that it's, the roads are kind of these byways. So all of a sudden you have this, you've got cars and people carting cargo and all these different things. So there was a lot of danger involved.
A whole different experience.
Yeah, much different than any other thing I've ever produced. So basically Jock Boyer is, who's the kind of man of the hour, he's the one who really allowed this whole thing to happen. He's the one who stepped in and has really carried this team to where they are today. And this is kind of family.
Why did you feel it so important to make this, to get this film out there and work as hard as you did to help get it where it is now?
In the very beginning, we actually, none of us had any real idea of where it was going to go. We didn't have a kind of end point of what we wanted to accomplish. We had basically a 3 months of budget to see where we could go. And I went in 2006 over there for 3 months, and it's been 6 years. And as it started to evolve, and as the riders got better and the lives were changed and the country was embracing cycling, it just was a story that just kept getting more and more important each time, you know, things happened.
Well, I mean, 7 years is such a long time. How did you keep people motivated and how did you keep yourself going on this marathon of a filmmaking?
A great team, a great story. As the story kept evolving, it kept getting more and more inspiring as seeing guys change and their lives change. It was, you didn't want to quit telling the story.
Good luck. Thank you so much, Rising from the Ashes. I hope our viewers will see it, and thanks for being here.
You bet.
I'm here with Susan Rockefeller and with her documentary, Mission of Mermaids, right?
Yes, it's Mission of Mermaids.
Congratulations, you're here.
Thank you so much.
And who's standing with you next?
Gina Bradley.
Hi, Gina.
Hi.
So Gina is with Paddle Diva, and we paddleboard. Right. We just went paddleboarding this morning. It's such a beautiful day to be in the Hamptons.
I jumped in the ocean, too. It's incredible.
It's fantastic.
Oh, it's fun.
And my film is screening tomorrow at 5:30 at the East Hampton Cinema East.
So tell me about Mission of Mermaids.
So Mission of Mermaids is a 15-minute film. It's made primarily of found footage. We only shot one day out here at Sagaponack, so all you viewers that know the Hamptons, you'll be able to recognize some of the beach scenes. And it is a poetic ode to help save our oceans before it's too late. I'm on the board of Oceana, which is a global organization solely focused on ocean protection, and it really is a way to engage people to understand the importance of our oceans and to save them, because so many people rely on fish protein. And I want to engage people's hearts through the myth of the mermaid, and through that, the fun of people loving oceans. People come out here because they love the ocean, but to let them also understand that if you love it, we need to save it, and these are the reasons why.
Now, you're wearing this fantastic mermaid jewelry. Tell me about it.
Thank you. Yeah, yes, this
it.
Is
I want that.
This is part of the School of Fish. Okay. And so this is a fish, and this is a signature chain. This is the Susan Rockefeller jewelry that goes with the film. It's part of a campaign message, because women, as you know, go to cocktail parties. We get inspired. We look at something. This is a seahorse, and it's a way of starting to talk about things that are important to us. So it's message inspired. Here's a little mermaid with a little sea star and an anchor. So the idea is that you can wear something and use that as a message to get the message out about our oceans.
Was there a reason that you wanted to keep it so short?
I wanted to keep it short because it lends itself to being on a slate with other films. Mm-hmm. It's great if you want to do a cocktail party and have a bunch of people come. We did a couple of those in the Hamptons.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then there's curriculum that will be, it's now credited for 5th through 8th grade, and that will go, it'll be digitally downloaded, so the film will have curriculum as well.
I think it's so smart because you don't want to overwhelm people. Then they just turn off and they
black it out. Right, and short and sweet, and then you have time to have questions. And
really good.
Yeah, so it's really like a poem. If you think about a novel, it's 300, 500 pages. You think about a poem, it's one page, it's 15 minutes, it's pared down, it's poetic. And I hope as many people as possible can come and see it.
Great. Great. Yes, our viewers will definitely come and support that. Now, Gina, you own Paddle Diva?
I do own Paddle Diva.
So much. I've seen your truck go by. I'm going to get on a paddle. And not only that, now I have to catch up and do yoga on a paddleboard.
Yes, that's the new thing.
But it's amazing. It's supposed to be amazing.
Yeah, it really is.
You do paddleboarding all over, up to when? When in the season?
Well, Susan and I went this morning. I mean, as long as the weather's warm and you have the right kind of protective gear, you can pretty much go year-round.
Really?
It's really my opportunity to interact with nature and kind of hit the reset button.
Okay, I will do it. I'm going to... Where can our viewers find you? Online or...?
Easiest place is at paddlediva.com. Okay. And I'm also up at the Shagwan Marina on Three Mile Harbor, but... In the winter, it gets a little cold, so.
Well, Susan, thank you so much. Gina, thank you so much. And good luck with your documentary. And I look forward to seeing it and getting our viewers out there to see it. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
And enjoy this beautiful weather.
Well, I'm here with Tim Duffy. And the movie is Drift. And the exciting part about it is two things. It's from Australia. And it's a surfing movie.
That's right.
The struggle of two brothers, actually.
Two brothers who start a surf brand back in the early 70s in Australia. And they start in their back shed, and then it grows into a huge company, which is, you know, similar to the big companies that are around now, like Quicksilver, Billabong. So, yeah, it's one of those stories.
So Quicksilver and Billabong, their roots were way back then.
Yeah, way back in the early 70s and late 60s in Australia in a small beach town, like similar to the beach towns around here. And these guys just started making stuff in their back shed. Of course, the difference was they turned into a billion-dollar business, you know.
And in those days, it was, of course, the nice longboards.
Yeah, that was just the period the film's set in. It's actually the transition from longboards to shortboards. So the guys in the movie do that. That's part of their business. They change the boards from longboards to shortboards.
And that whole lifestyle, and you know, although they never surfed, the Beach Boys here in the States developed a whole subculture.
Yeah.
And we interviewed years ago a guy that ordered. He was a former airline pilot, and he ended up. Having a board shipped by rail all the way here to East Hampton, and he tested it out in ditch planes.
Yeah.
And at the time, it was revolutionary.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
But aside from waxing into the world of surfing, tell the viewers at home about the movie. Just a thumbnail.
It starts off with the boys being young kids who whose father is a drunk and really not a good guy, and with the mother they escape. The town they grew up in, which is Sydney, and they decide to get as far away as they can from their father and the things going on. So they end up in this very remote town, sort of, you know, hiding out. And then they have to make a life there, and they're really poor, and the kids got nothing that they can do well except surf. So they just start making surfboards and selling them to the local guys and girls, and it grows from there.
And to make a surfboard is not an easy thing because it's... First of all, it has to put up with harsh environment of the ocean, you know, and constantly being hit. And the pressure on the nose is like, I don't know how many G's hit that thing when it's really going. How did they get the materials and the know-how and the engineering to do it?
It's funny because in the movie, that when they start off, they've only got one board they share between two of them. And they actually smash the board, you know, when they're learning. So they bring it in and it's a necessity. They actually have to refix the board so they can keep using it. And when they fix it, it actually works better. So then they kind of go, well, let's make another one, and they make another one, and they sell that, and the whole company builds from smashing their first board.
And just by word of mouth, they created...
Yeah, literally word of mouth, that's how the whole surf business started. It turned from literally whoever could make the best board or the best wetsuit or the best pair of shorts would get word of mouth, and then more people would buy it. So the whole industry is built on word of mouth.
And what brought you to the movie? Are you a surfer?
Yeah, I'm a surfer. I grew up surfing in a region in Australia, and... you know, we'd seen a fair few movies made, dramatic movies made about surfing, but we never felt like they were really as authentic as they could be. So we thought it'd be cool to do a story that's really a true story, really authentic, but has lots of action and you know, a rags to riches story, like about some kids that made good.
I'm going to ask you a few technical questions about the way it was shot. First of all, did you use GoPro at all or anything like that?
We did actually, yeah. We used GoPro for particularly some of the big wave sequences. We shot the film in really big surf. We decided that was one of the things we wanted to do. And so we had the GoPro in a lot of the, the big surf, and you know, because it's so small and easy to use, we could tie it to the surfer or to a boat or whatever.
And the quality's excellent. The
quality's great.
The camera's trash. You're not crying all the way back to the hotel room.
We unfortunately drowned a few cameras.
That's good. Yeah. Those are the notches on the surfboard.
That's right.
And the other thing is, it was shot on film or?
It was shot on digital video or, you know, digital cameras, which are now pretty much the standard. Yeah, we were ready to shoot it on film, and we tested the latest digital cameras.
Which one did you?
It was a mix. It was an Alexa by Arriflex, and they were our main cameras, and we also used the Red Epic, which is the two,
Yeah. And the post-production was done?
It was all done at Fox Studios in Australia. Yeah.
Excellent, yeah. Excellent. So you have distribution with Fox?
No, Fox Studios is just the post facility. We're actually distributing the film in the US through Wreck and Hill, which is an independent company who've done films like, you know, Memento, Donnie Darko. So they're great. They're on board, and we've sold the film all over the world already. So.
Well, the film is Drift. The website, which is archaic now, but your Twitter page, Facebook, so the viewers at home can keep in touch with you.
It's Drift the Movie is the website. We're just setting ourselves up for a release of the film in April next year, so the site will be sort of fully functional within the next couple of weeks.
Well, keep your eyes out for Drift, and it's a incredible motion picture world premiere from Australia, and everything good comes out of Australia. 113 minutes English. Be on the lookout for it. Go to the webpage and the Facebook. And again, the movie is Drift, and welcome to the festival.
Thank you very much.
I'm here with Cynthia Wade, whose film is here at the Hamptons International Film Festival, Mondays at Racine. Hi, Cynthia.
Hi.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And we have the two ladies who made it all possible, Rachel and Cynthia.
Hi, guys.
Rachel and Cynthia.
How are you, Zoe?
So nice to meet you both, and you made it possible, this film. Can you tell our viewers, first of all, Cynthia, a little bit about the film? Because it's airing, when is it airing, first of all?
Well, it'll be on HBO in 2013. We've got three screenings this weekend, a Saturday, a Sunday, and a Monday screening, so we're about to go into that. This Mondays at Racine is a film about a salon on Long Island, in Islip, Long Island, where once a month the doors close to the general public and are only open to women undergoing chemotherapy. And these are women who are losing their hair, their eyelashes, their eyebrows, their sense of self, their sense of beauty, sort of their sense of place in the world, and they come into a very safe space where Cynthia and Rachel, who started this because their mother died of breast cancer, and it will be 23 years on Monday, which is our big screening on Monday, which is a kind of an amazing coincidence. They started it because they saw their mother not treated well by her friends, by the community, by the public, and they wanted to be able to create a safe space for women where they can feel beautiful and they can vent and they can laugh and they can cry. So I spent 2 years going back every Monday to the salon, and then followed women as either their lives got better or their marriages fell apart or they found out who they really were married to or they had to step away from their careers, and the impact of cancer on their lives.
Wow, so what really was surprising to you as you watched this movie unfold?
The most surprising thing to me was that losing your hair, losing one's hair, was much more traumatic to women than losing their breasts or their ovaries or any body part. Every single woman, and I followed many, many women over the course of 2 years, every single woman said, it wasn't losing my breasts that hurt, it was losing my hair. Wow. So what is it about hair that is so important to our sense of either safety or identity, beauty? And it's certainly once your hair goes and your eyelashes and your eyebrows go, you really are then saying to the world, at that point, it becomes very public. Your disease becomes very public. I am struggling with cancer. I am fighting cancer. And I think that's hard for people.
Unbelievable. And what an amazing way to remember your mother. So can you tell me a little bit about, you know, what Mondays are like there? I mean, do people come back? And you must be a real support for these women.
We've turned out to be quite a support system. We not only can help people with their beauty needs, we do a lot of head shaving there, of course, manicures, massages, all the kind of stuff, lashes. But we've become a networking for women who need doctors, who need other services for themselves. And we've grown, we're the phones are ringing constantly now. We're almost like this resource center. And we do it lovingly and willingly. And it's almost, for Rachel and I, effortless. Because there's a need in our community. And as business people in the community, we feel like it's our role to give back to the community.
It seems like there's a need in every community. Yeah. I mean, that's what I can't believe is that this hasn't been done before.
Well, I think that it has been done before, but probably on a smaller scale in terms of, in every community, stylists and salons have patients that are going through, or clients that are going through cancer. But we organize something for a very private time for these women to come in so they could feel free without a wig on and can really, you know, ironically let their hair down without having their hair. But I definitely think that what would be important and inspiring to as an outcome on this film is that we might be able to inspire other spas and salons to do the same in their community, because traditionally we are in our industry, Mondays are a closed day, so it doesn't take a lot to be able to have this type of setup.
And I just want to say that it is Breast Cancer Awareness Month as well, so how eloquent a time to come out. And I hope our viewers get to see this film. It sounds amazing. And thank you so much for everything you do. And I just wanted to say that it will be also on HBO,
yep.
Airing on HBO in 2013. So if you can't get to the film festival and meet these women, you can see it on HBO.
And there's also a great trailer, Mondays at Racine.com. And there's a really nice trailer that sort of tells the story and the story of Cynthia and Rachel and some of their clients. So if people are interested, they can at least get a preview there, Mondays at Racine.com.
Okay, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Enjoy the festival.
Thank you.
Zoe Pennybaker-Breen and Greg Schimese here. We've come to the end of the show, sadly.
What a great show. I had so much fun. And it's so much fun. I mean, you can read the little excerpts in the guide, but when you get to really talk to the directors and the people involved and the actors, it's amazing. It really is.
And we encourage you to come down. If you're in the area, come down to the Hamptons Film Festival. If not, look at the HamptonsFilmFest.org, the website. And follow their Twitters and follow all their Facebook entries. And above all, support filmmaking here on the East End and filmmaking throughout the United States. It's an endangered species.
And I think, you know, going to the film festival and seeing movies, it's just so exciting because you never know what you're going to find, you know? It's just such, you can find treasures and you can be a part of the beginning of these films. I saw that. I saw that at the film festival. Everyone's like, how did you see that? So, you know, it's a really fun experience.
And there's something for everyone. So just come on down.
Absolutely.
And before we leave, we want to give a special congratulations and tribute to D.A. Pennybaker, your dad, because D.A. Was awarded an Oscar. It took a long time, but as always, they eventually honor the people that really were the mainstays. And D.A. is a founding father of documentary filmmaking, as we know, not only here in the United States, but throughout the world. And tip of the hat to D.A. Pennybaker at home. And
so proud of you, Dad. Congratulations.
And terrific. And, you know, we're really honored that you're part of the East End and have always been part of the East End. And congratulations to you. Stay tuned to WVVH-TV, Hamptons TV. The television station that has documented the film festival for over 20 years, and hopefully as we churn ahead, we
in
will
20
keep
years more. We'll be here.
We'll be here.
In our wheelchairs.
Or a frozen head like Walt Disney. Thank you very much.
Oh, gosh.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks for joining us.